Thanks, everybody, for being here. Good morning. I want to introduce my firm. I suspect that D.A. Davidson doesn't roll off your lips when you think of securities firms, so let me tell you a little bit about my firm. We're a broker-dealer, employee-owned. We're celebrating our 80th birthday this year, quite proud of that. It took an act of extraordinary courage to start a broker-dealer in 1935 in Montana, but we've survived and prospered. Pretty conventional business model, about 70% private client, 30% capital markets. Most of our business is done west of the Mississippi, although we do have offices throughout the United States. But a majority of our offices and our business is on the West Coast and the Northern Rockies. And my perspective and some of my thoughts this morning will obviously reflect my background and my experience with my firm. I'm going to offer a few comments on SIFMA and the industry, and then I'll turn it over to Ken for some more specific comments. In part, my comments this morning are intended to show that the financial services extends well beyond what is commonly referred to in the popular culture as Wall Street. The use of the term Wall Street to identify and characterize the industry and SIFMA's membership distorts and oversimplifies the reality. The industry is large and complex, but it's not a monolith. And SIFMA and its membership reflect both the size and the diversity of the industry. Our membership and the industry range from large global banks and asset managers to very small broker-dealers with a handful of employees. 60% of SIFMA broker-dealer members have annual revenues of less than $50 million and 75% less than $200 million. The financial firms that are members of SIFMA and in the United States vary substantially by size and business model, yet all provide a valuable service to individual investors and to local capital formation. In total, the financial services industry employs nearly 900,000 people across the country. There are 4,000 separate registered broker-dealers with 375,000 financial advisors located in more than 160,000 branch offices in communities throughout the nation. A substantial majority of the industry firms, SIFMA members, and industry employees are located off Wall Street. Nearly half of industry employment and the majority of SIFMA member firms are represented by regional, or in many cases, small firms headquartered in such places as Indianapolis, Little Rock, Memphis, Louisville, Tampa, St. Pete, St. Louis, Buffalo, Wheeling, West Virginia, Minneapolis, Kansas City, San Francisco, and even Great Falls, Montana. I'm employed by one of those firms and see every day the work of our member firms and their employees and the contributions we make to our clients, communities, and the economy in Main Street America. Collectively, our financial advisors provide investment services to millions of individual investors with more than $13 trillion in client assets under administration. This capital is the capital that drives our economy and will be used by our investors to fund children and grandchildren's education, retirement, or other business or personal objectives. We also provide research coverage, make markets, provide liquidity, raise capital, and serve as valued advisors for thousands of companies and businesses from multi-billion dollar global enterprises to startup businesses and small public companies. We're essential participants in the debt markets, both as advisors and underwriters of corporate, government, and municipal debt, and we're key supporters of the secondary fixed income markets. And notably, and I think very importantly, most of us are very deeply engaged in the communities in which we do business. It's easy and convenient to describe the role and importance of our industry relative to our country's economy and prosperity with abstractions, broad generalizations, and macroeconomic statistics. But I believe there's a powerful truth in observing the particular and everyday examples of the industry at work. Here are a few. Helping a couple develop and execute a savings and investment plan, and then observing their ability to educate their children and enjoy their retirement. Underwriting a bond issue to finance a new school, a hospital, or a critical transportation or other infrastructure project. Advising a family-owned business on the sale of the business, and then advising the family on investment of the proceeds from the sale. And working with a startup company to access early stage capital, assisting it in a public offering, and providing research and liquidity for its investors. I see these examples in my business all the time, and they are repeated across the industry millions of times. On the whole, 2014 has been a good year for the industry. My perspective, as I noted before, is that of a CEO of a regional firm. Our business is about 70% private client, working with individual investors, and about 30% capital markets, both equity and fixed income. And as I noted, most of our business is in the West. But I think my observations are generally valid with respect to the industry as a whole. For the private client and wealth management business at our firm, and I believe at most firms, 2014 will be a record or near record year, measured by revenues and productivity, and in many cases, profitability. This performance is particularly noteworthy given that net interest income from cash management programs is very depressed, and historically this has been a source of significant revenue and profitability for wealth management businesses. The business has been driven by strong equity markets and the continued movement of clients and advisors to fee-based models that focus on wealth management and financial planning and away from the more transactional model. Our clients, in particular, tend to be investors and not traders. The fixed income business this past year has been challenged by a low interest rate environment, which you're all aware, uncertainty concerning future interest rate trends, and the impact of regulatory change. The regulatory change in the municipal market has been particularly impactful for the regional firms. M&A activity is very strong. Certainly the large headline transactions are evidence of this, but activity has also been robust for smaller deals involving small and mid-sized businesses. The regional and smaller firms have also participated in a very good year for public equity underwritings, both IPOs and follow-on offerings. As we look forward to 2015, SIFMA will remain focused on a number of important regulatory and other issues. Ken will provide more detail and specifics. But two large themes will guide our efforts. First, we need to continue to be proactive in identifying and responding to issues with fresh ideas and solutions. We did so very effectively this past year relative to several matters, including cybersecurity, market structure, and senior issues. And second, we will continue to advocate for balanced regulatory reform and administration that respect cost and benefit and investor protection, choice, and responsibility. So with that, I will turn it over to Ken.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Bill. And I'll make a couple of points first following on Bill's comments on some market statistics at sort of a high level. And I would at the outset commend to you both the year in review book that you have or has been sent to you for those who are not in the room, and the 2014 yearbook, and also the quarterly research report, which came out a few days ago, which hopefully everyone received. And if you didn't, we'll make sure that you get a copy of it. Bill touched on this, that we, you know, as we look at the end of the third quarter, you know, we see total issuance down slightly compared to this period a year ago, with in some cases mortgage-related agencies and treasuries showing a little bit of an upward trend in issuance, municipals, corporates, and asset equity and asset-backed securities showing a downtrend in issuance year over year. Looking at corporate debt issuance, we did see that almost 1,000 U.S. companies issued $1.1 trillion in corporate bonds through the third quarter of this year, which is on track so far with where we were before. 225 companies conducted IPOs, raising over $80 billion in new capital, and it was the strongest first three quarters on record, even excluding the record-breaking Alibaba IPO. And municipal issuers raised over $230 billion so far this year. Importantly, as was released late yesterday, I believe respondents to our municipal issuance survey expect total municipal issuance to reach $357 billion for $348 billion in 2014, but are expecting an uptick to $357 billion in 2015 in their projections. I want to go into some comments following also on Bill's comments with respect to proactive and I guess I would say reactive regulatory issues that we're working on this year, and then we can open it up for questions. So as Bill pointed out, there are a number of areas where SIFMA's members, through our leadership, are trying to take a forward step in working with our regulators and the industry more broadly. On those, I would, in addition to market structure, which I'll make some comments on, and senior investors, I'd start with cybersecurity. This is an area where the industry has spent a great deal of time and effort over the last several years, but nonetheless is an area where we can obviously continue to see increasing risk, increasing level of attacks, and it's something that SIFMA undertook as a major initiative over the last year. We've been in the process of looking at the industry in terms of an industry weakness diagnostic, taking the NIST framework and developing specific industry standards that can be adopted across all sizes of broker-dealers and asset managers, and then something that we can work collaboratively with our regulators on. We've been engaged in ensuring that the industry works across the board in participating in the various information sharing platforms, including FSISAC, and as you noticed in today's press, there's a number of stories about the recently announced Sultra Edge, and that's a FSISAC initiative that and DTCC that SIFMA and its members are deeply engaged in. We've worked on establishing, improving our protocols for market recovery. And this follows on our standard business continuity practices and protocols that we exercise on a regular basis. In addition, as Bill mentioned, in market structure, SIFMA and its members at the highest level undertook an in-depth review of equity market structure. This follows on our longstanding call for a wholesale review of Reg NMS. And earlier this year, this summer, we came out with principles for reform of U.S. equity market structure, notwithstanding the fact, and we made this very clear in our comments, that U.S. equity markets today are much more efficient than they have been in any time. But notwithstanding that, clearly complexity, questions around technology and transparency could serve to affect investor trust and confidence. And our members feel strongly that the SEC and the industry should take steps to address those concerns. As Bill mentioned, with respect to senior investors, this is an emerging issue that SIFMA has been working on across sort of a multidisciplinary effort within SIFMA, and also in collaboration with our members and with our regulators at both the federal and state level. There have been a number of meetings, roundtables, and our hope is that from this effort, working with our regulators, that we can develop policies and processes to address an issue that all of our member firms and society more broadly are having to address. On the regulatory front, I would point out of our top non-Dodd-Frank, and I'll get to Dodd-Frank, but our top non-Dodd-Frank priorities where we're focused, we continue to be very concerned with the Department of Labor's proposed amendments to ERISA that similar to what they had proposed back in 2010 and subsequently withdrew, but the fact that the department continues to put on its agenda that it wants to bring a rule that would make changes to ERISA that we believe would be counterproductive to the interest of our members' clients. And so this continues to be an issue that we are deeply engaged in. In addition, FINRA's CARDS proposal, many of you all may have seen or hopefully saw the comment letter that we filed on Monday in opposition to FINRA's CARDS proposal. This is, I think, it's the third comment letter that we've filed, and I think you'll also note that there's, you know, pretty broad-based opposition to this big data approach to, you know, trying to collect all investor data on a monthly basis to be held in one, you know, quasi-government central data repository that our members feel is both an invasion is an invasion of privacy, raises significant risk, particularly cyber risk, and is effectively a sledgehammer approach to what FINRA has described as is trying to identify much smaller problems at significant cost. We believe far greater costs than FINRA has estimated to the industry and ultimately to our clients. In addition, we continue to work on in anticipation of the SROs coming out with a consolidated audit trail proposal perhaps later this year, and we're working with DTCC on a shortened settlement cycle that we expect movement on later this year. And we're watching and we've been engaged rather, and we've been engaged on the Federal Reserve's earlier AMPR with respect to commodities activities of banks and financial institutions, and we anticipate that there will be a proposed rulemaking at some point on that. Mm-hmm. On the Dodd-Frank front, obviously we continue to work through implementation. We're, you know, the regulators are about 60% through their Dodd-Frank rulemaking, but notwithstanding the fact that there's still 40% of the rules to be proposed, there's a tremendous amount of work that's being done on the implementation front. So it runs the gamut from, you know, all of Titles 1 and 2 prudential regulation. The areas where we are most focused on are the continued work on orderly liquidation authority, FSOC designation, particularly as it relates to non-bank entities and asset managers, and the process around FSOC designation, the implementation of the Volcker Rule, where there continues to be a tremendous amount of work, both as it relates to prop trading and funds, the derivative space, where on the one hand, working on the various rules that the CFTC has promulgated, as well as in anticipation of the SEC's rules for their share of that work. On the municipal advisor, which the implementation of the municipal advisor rule and the various in the new regime that that puts in place, with the advent of the Reg AB2 and risk retention rules, working with our members on that process, and we still anticipate at some point in time that the SEC and Chair White, as you know, made this comment at our annual meeting that there will be some activity as it relates to Section 913 Uniform Standard of Care for brokers and advisors when providing personalized investment advice. This is something that SIFMA and its members have strongly supported, and we anticipate that the SEC will be commenting on that in some form or fashion in the very near future. In terms of outlook for Congress, you know, we are watching through the lame duck session what's going on with tax extenders. We have a few items that we're interested in there, as well as some potential movement with some Dodd-Frank fixes that are being discussed in the Congress, as well as potential action with respect to eminent domain and addressing concerns about those entities that want to utilize eminent domain to seize mortgages, utilizing the Federal Housing Administration's programs and risk to the taxpayers related to that. I'd also mention in the states, We continue to focus on a variety of issues, but in particular, I would point out eminent domain being one. The other would be various states looking at creating state-run private employee retirement plans. California, Connecticut, Illinois, Maryland, West Virginia, Washington State, and Oregon have all been looking at sponsoring such programs. I mentioned senior investor issues. This is a collaboration that we have with the state regulators on that. And then I would mention various states over the last year, and we anticipate in the next year will be looking at various tax issues. In particular, in the past, we've seen efforts for things like stock transfer taxes, as well as tax on or fees on services. That is something that our members are concerned about. Lastly, just from a global perspective, we continue to focus on the development of a legal entity identifier. It's been picked up principally between, in Europe, beginning to be picked up in Asia. The CFTC has adopted it here, and it is a priority for our global group to have uniform application of that as part of systemic risk monitoring. We're also engaged with IOSCO on their efforts to establish a protocol or processes for dealing with mutual recognition and substituted compliance, as well as the work that FSB is doing related to that. And FSB's work now that they are sort of at the end of their promulgation of various rules that filter down to the various regional jurisdictions, including the U.S., as they go towards implementation and peer review. With that, I will stop, and there are a number of issues we didn't mention, but we'll open it up for questions.
Great.